a $150 donation from MudJoe2, and they are talking about an upcoming incentive for Crypt of the NecroDancer. He says, the Family Jewels track has been dominating the soundtrack bid. Let's make it interesting and help. He wants to put this money toward Avert to give Family Jewels a run for their money. If you check it out with the Crypt of the NecroDancer speedrun, which is coming up on Thursday evening, there is a soundtrack choice, and it's going between Family Jewels 7X, which are guitar rock metal covers, and Vert, which is retro style chiptune, Arrival, of course, Danny B's original versions, or the synthwave versions from Girlfriend Records. So if you want to help set this soundtrack that'll be listened to while that run is happening, that is an open incentive. Speaking of incentives, the next one coming up will be during CubeFace's Hexen run. We have a class choice bid war happening right now. So it's not, I shouldn't say incentive, it's a bid war. Yeah, he will definitely be playing as a class, and you get to bid to choose which one it'll be. And now a brief message from this summer's biggest blockbuster.
In a world where you can make a difference, one marathon, one charity, one mission, it's Summer Games Done Quick 2016.
How y'all doing? I am Prolix here reading your donations. Thanks, Bob, for all the doom hype leading up to this. I appreciate it. I have $25 here from Fruit Dude, who says, not the pun announcer, more like not the fun announcer. Commentary is doomed, apparently. And then he says, no, really, you're dooming great. Well, thanks, Fruit Dude. And no, I apologize. I do love puns personally. However, it's somebody else's shtick, right? I can't just steal it. I feel bad about that. So, but thank you so much for the donation. Your generosity has been great all week long, everyone. Thanks for all the doom hype. On a non-doom note, Anonymous sent in $100 saying, got to get that Japanese Jack and Daxter run. That way Bonesaw can play it in his native language. So that's another upcoming incentive. Later tonight, Jack and Daxter. There's a bid open right now. We'd play it in Japanese and watch the opening cutscene if that gets met. As we finish prepping for the Ultimate Doom bonus run here, just wanted to mention this is Summer Games Done Quick 2016. We are speedrunning games all week long in support of Doctors Without Borders. All of your donations go directly to Doctors Without Borders. They support people who cannot otherwise access healthcare. They employ specialized medical and logistic help to get longer-term projects up and running. At any one time, some 30,000 doctors, nurses, epidemiologists, and sanitation experts can be found providing assistance to some of the world's most vulnerable patients. We thank MSF for their valuable work, and we couldn't be happier to be here helping raise money for them and getting to watch more Doom while we're at it. I mean, am I right? You know.
You're right.
I have confirmation that I was correct for once in my life. Thank you. Kitty Cactus donated $100 to MSF and said thanks to all of the runners for the great entertainment every year. And thank you, Kitty, for the generosity.
This map isn't in the speedrun.
Just wanted to show it off.
All right, time to play some more Doom, everyone.
Doom. Alrighty, so this was the donation incentive, and I just want to thank everybody for their generosity, because that was pretty crazy in the last 4 hours. So Ultimate Doom came out in 1995. So the original game was episodes 1 through 3 in 1993. So you had to share We're Knee Deep in the Dead, and then you had to buy Shores of Hell and Inferno. And then there was an expansion episode that was released in 95, so Thy Flesh Consumes. So we're going to do 1 through 4, and I'm going to be starting in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
Doom.
Yeah, Doom.
Dooming up. So for this E1M1, as a matter of fact, that little skip there was added in the Ultimate Doom, so that just makes this level even faster, which is quite handy.
Are you sure?
I'm definitely sure. I remember reading that somewhere.
I didn't even know that.
So you'll notice a reduced monster variety in Doom 1 because they just didn't have it. In Doom 2, they added the super shotgun, so we're missing the best weapon in the game. And we're also missing important enemies like Arachnotrons, Mancubus, Archviles, etc. So this run is a lot more basic, and you'll see some more hit scans, at least no chain gunners, and we'll see some Barons at later points, and that's kind of annoying. But it's still a really cool run just because of the movement capability. You don't have to worry about as many enemies all the time, but there can be a lot that just get in the way, and even though they're easy to kill, sometimes it's a big pain in the butt to deal with it when you don't have the super shotgun.
Well, you don't have the SSG, but there's also just very, very high density of shotgunners in some of these maps, which in Plutonia are pretty much all chain gunners instead, which are even better. But shotgunners can do anywhere between about 3 and 45 damage. So there's a huge variance there. So a map like E1M3 is... Sometimes you can do everything right, and you'll just still die. But right now we've got some really high health, so we're going to be fine.
You'll also notice that, in general, the Ultimate Doom levels don't quite have as many skips and whatnot. There's still a good handful of them, but most of it is just making excellent use of the movement mechanics. This is an example of a skip right here. It's going to SR50 onto, I think you can actually SR40 it, but it's a different setup.
You can SR40, but it's much more difficult.
And the hardest thing in the game, opening that door. That door is surprisingly hard to open. I wasn't even making like a dime is bad joke there.
Sometimes it just doesn't want to open for you.
Yeah, it's weird. So he goes specifically to that area just to have a wall fall down. And then there's a bunch of enemies in the way. This level in particular ends most attempts at this episode because of the ridiculous monster density. And he didn't even quite get it because the enemies were in the way there. There we go. Oh, sorry, it doesn't... It raises the platform. It doesn't drop.
Yeah, I just had to hit a trigger there, but I didn't quite go forward enough, so I missed it. So most of episode 1 was the levels were designed by John Romero, except for I think there was some additional help on E1M4 and E1M8. So what Sandy Peterson mainly did M8, and I'm not sure about M4, if somebody remembers.
Well, I know. I believe Tom Hall had some influence in the first
Tom
episode.
Hall.
So, yeah.
I'm going to go for the Soul Sphere. I'm pretty low.
Oh, chain gun. I saw chainsaw. It was definitely not a chain gun there. Come on. Okay. I mean, this is an excellent example of why this is... You would have already just ended your attempt right there. Just because of the ridiculous enemies.
Yeah, just ridiculously bad luck. So since we don't have the SSG, it's kind of... It's really hard to power through pinkies, because it's going to take 2 or 3 hits to deal with them at any time.
Yeah, and you'll notice a lot of the corridors in Ultimate Doom, as opposed to the areas in Plutonia, are a lot skinnier, so it's a lot harder to just kind of maneuver around enemies. You usually have to kind of clear them out a little bit more.
I was going to be mad if that pistol guy killed him, because I think he could have at 12% right there.
Well, it was a shotgunner, not a pistol guy.
Oh, was it shot?
Man. Yeah.
Definitely could have killed him. Then.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Too bad.
The bites, man. The friggin' bites.
Yeah, bites can do up to 40 damage, so did like a mid-tier bite there. But I'm not like 100% shocked, because I would say this is maybe the hardest level in the run outside of like E4M6.
Yeah.
There's a lot of frustrating elements to it. You're going through tight spaces, tons of enemies.
And then see the difference in the enemies right there. I mean, nothing was really getting in the way. A fun little fact, you'll notice that the teleporter here is shaped in a pentagram. The teleporters used in later episodes and in Doom 2 and whatnot are actual textures that have pentagrams on them. In Episode 1 and Episode 1 only, they're actually shaped, like the surface is shaped in a pentagram. And that's just a little touch they added to add somewhat of the demonic theming that they had in the game.
That death was unfortunate. It was at the very, very end.
He was in
like
the exit.
Last room. Alright. Okay, there we go.
Yay.
Yay.
Redemption.
So biggest time saver in the run, arguably, is right here, because I can save 35 seconds just by doing that. So pretty much a wall came down, and once you go about here, you trigger it to lower, and if you have an enemy in the way, it just goes straight back up.
And otherwise, you would have to just kind of wait out a gauntlet, which is easily killed, and then you have to wait like half a minute for it to eventually come back up again.
We finally get the rocket launcher here. Well, we get it on map 5, but we don't use it so much until this one.
Yeah, the rockets in, I would say in most of Doom 1 are fairly sparse, so you have to be very tactical about using them correctly.
I think I'm just wrong. You use it a lot in like map 5, but sometimes I can't think too well while I'm playing this game. Everything just goes so fast.
Well, I mean, in Plutonia, you're just using it all the time, so
yeah.
Just by comparison, it's like never. We're not even going to see the plasma rifle until the next episode and the BFG in the third episode, so they really spaced out the weapons because the enemy variety is rather low, and you don't really need a BFG to fight shotgunners.
Yeah, I think there's only, about 20-odd rockets picked up in the Episode 1 route. Maybe less.
I'd say 20 to 25,
yeah.
I'd say.
Yeah, I mean, use a few on the Barons. He used a few here and a few in the last level for that one group. Something. This is just a really long run of a level, so.
Yeah, you can do donations for this one.
I have a $100 donation from John Sweet that I've been wanting to read for a while. John writes, I hope Dime can scythe through this speedrun like a supernova. I will give him a resurgence of energy to do so via this donation. No ancient aliens will stop this valiant run. May no revenant agitate him.
That has to be like the most obscure reference right there.
The
Doom community knows it for sure, but it's just... Yeah. It's great. Thank you,
Jerry. For anyone who doesn't know, there were 5 custom map sets listed in that donation. Maybe 6. I only heard 5 for sure.
Oh, also there was new strats in this run. Like the only new strats. I shot 2 rockets, which we didn't use to shoot. And that was kind of came up with by Zero Master.
He has the record in this run. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
Also a $200.50 donation from Anonymous. Just says, shout out to the whole Classic FPS crew. Thank you, Anonymous. And Twitch chat can prepare their emotes because Cody Rhodes sends in $250 and says, I'm literally pog champing while watching every run. I can't wait for the rest of the speedruns to come.
Yeah, so as we mentioned in Plutonia, Zero Master owns like most of the like really classic Doom records. At this
point. Has every single UV and most of the nightmares. He does technically doesn't have TNT because TNT hasn't been done yet. But
does anybody care about TNT?
Well, nightmare. I mean,
you care about the truck, don't you?
It's got a really cool truck.
So that was the boss of those 2 Barons, which we were casually destroying in Plutonia, and that is the end of the episode 1. So we're moving straight on to Shores of Hell. And now you'll notice that the teleporters don't look like pentagrams. I don't know, just reference there. But this is also where the runs start to get a little more hectic. I would say that the E1 episode is the longest. It is, but the next three are going to be a lot shorter, or supposed to be a lot shorter, but you also have some nasty situations and some particularly difficult skips to perform, I would say, especially in this next episode right here.
Yeah, we're going to be seeing a unique trick in episode 2 called the Void Glide, and we actually clip out of bounds, which is something you don't see too much in Classic Doom. Mm.
In fact, I believe that is the only time you're going to do it in the run. I'm sure there's potentially other areas you could do it, but nowhere else where you could do it and then finish the level.
not 100%. Well, in the run, yeah, but in ILs you can do it. In E1M8 is you can clip out and get straight to the teleporter, I believe.
Oh, huh.
Didn't know that.
Whoops. There is a backup strat here, so I'm still fine.
Yeah.
So right there, I pressed the switch, and no Z-axis, so it was way above me, and I still pressed it.
This game has good physics. This is the intermission music between levels, by the way. You probably won't hear the intermission music because we just go so quickly, but most Doomers just know this song, and it's like, why is it playing in the middle of a level? It's weird.
I'd say next about two maps are less interesting, so you can do more donations.
You got it. Akira Katayama gave us $50 and said, okay, I missed the chance to donate toward our jaunty trip through hell, and then I missed the chance to donate toward the Pepsi Man cutscenes. Dang it, I'm going to donate toward something, though, so here's $50 toward moving into that cow level in Diablo 2. Thanks, Akira. Also, $100 from James E6, who says, I look forward to the Games Done Quick events each year. Keep saving frames and being awesome. Thanks so much, James.
That is a sneak peek of the best texture in the game.
Oh, God, please no.
No, something I was wondering, do we know Cubeface's favorite class in Hexen?
Cleric?
Okay.
It's definitely cleric.
All right.
Absolutely.
All right. So we do have upcoming for Hexen in a couple games here. There's the class choice bid war. So if you wanna give Cubeface's wish, vote cleric with your dollars. If you want to troll him, go wizard or something else.
So I never used to make that mistake, but I do it all the time now, so I guess I'm just lazy in this area.
I didn't quite get that. There's something called a line def skip. A lot of the triggers in this game are created by just using a line segment and then saying something happens when you cross it. You can make the two barons not show up by avoiding touching that particular line. So. We don't like barons, so we just want to get rid of them whenever possible.
Yeah, especially in Doom 1 when we don't have the extra firepower of like the BFG in the earlier episodes.
Yeah, barons are known as doors with health, so.
Yes. Yes, they are.
So here's E2M6, so we have the Void Glide coming up. Mm-mm-mm. So I'm going to find a very specific wall to clip out of.
Yeah, the way this works is that because of the particular geometry of the level, mainly that it's not like at a north, south, east, west type angle, when you're trying to perform what I was calling the...
That was fast.
Good, that's the good start. When you're trying to get that whole teleport attempt position thing...
Oh, yeah.
Sorry.
Wow! Okay.
Okay. It's just world record right there. But yeah, the teleport attempt position just goes completely haywire when you're at a weird geometry and you're bouncing around until eventually the game decides to try to push you like more than 32 units in a single tick. Dang it, barons. Demons? They might as well be barons for as annoying as they are.
Okay, come on.
This is a rocket jump as much as you can jump in this game.
We can do it. I think I'm doing it. Must be too early. Okay, let's kill these guys first.
There's a few different setups you can perform on this rocket jump. I believe there's one for SR-40 and for SR-50. But it's a very specific setup. There we go.
So one of the reasons he's trying to do that without killing the pinkies is because he wants to save his plasma for this level so he can kill the Cyber Demon a little bit faster. Because the plasma rifle has a little bit higher DPS than rockets.
A little bit higher, yeah.
This might be one of the most famous Doom levels just because of the way that it's set up. And there's this awesome Cyber Demon duel with rockets and stuff. I know this scared me as a little kid, because I was awesome and was able to play this when I was, like, six, so.
There we go.
And that is episode two.
Episode two, yeah.
To move straight on episode three, we start with a little enemy manipulation there. By having the Cacodemons move out of the way, by having them... He just uses his pistol, basically, to say, I'm over here, and then the position of where he is moves the Cacodemons specifically where he wants them to go so that he can get right out and continue on, because they're blocking him otherwise.
Yeah, and the one interesting thing you'll note about Doom 1 is you notice that the boss-type monster of Episode 1 was the Barons, and you see those a few times throughout Episode 2. The Cyber Demon being the boss of Episode 2, you will see... kind of is not exactly a boss monster in a later point.
He actually shows up in Warren's, which is the secret level of this one.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, he's... I mean, I would still call him kind of the hardest enemy, but for some reason he's overshadowed by the Spider Mastermind due to just the girth, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I don't even think it would make a difference, just because the BFG is so strong. Even the Cyber Demon would go down in a few hits.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention that level was shaped like a finger with a hand with a booger on one of its fingers.
Did we explain how the BFG worked?
We didn't. Well, we tried to during Plutonia, but we got cut off by tricks and stuff. So basically how the BFG works is oftentimes you'll see Dime maybe shoot a BFG shot off of a wall and just a bunch of enemies will melt into the ground after they get hit by it. So when you shoot it, it shoots out a main blast, which locks in an angle that Doom Guy shot at. After the main blast hits an enemy or a wall or any other surface, really, the BFG itself, from where Doom Guy is standing, will shoot out 41 tracers within a prescribed range of an arc in front of him. Those tracers will deal, I don't remember what the damage is exactly, but something around 40 maybe each.
They're the main source of damage.
Yeah. The main projectile does a couple hundred, like 800 damage.
Yeah, it's 100 to 800. It's, yeah, 100 it's pretty to 800, big okay. variable. But the tracers, I mean, with theoretical best luck, you can one-shot a Cyber Demon, but due to the Doom... whoops, that was
no,
key grab.
You can one-shot the Spider.
Well, I meant if you, like, removed the way that Doom does its RNG.
Oh, yeah, okay. But it is actually possible to one-shot a Spider Mastermind... with the BFG. Two shots is
it's
typically
mostly two shots. You only usually see a one shot if you're using a modern source for it, like Z-Doom, etc.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So in E3 M4 there, you might not have noticed, but I did a key grab. And I was just looking at a specific angle, and the faster you go, the further you can essentially grab through the wall. So I'm going to strafe into it. Or that's what I did.
Yeah, it's pretty funny how this game chooses to work at times. It's still a great game, and the fact that there are just these incredibly subtle but awesome tricks just makes it all the better, and it's the reason that it's lasted for as long as it has.
Okay, rip stream.
Yeah,
so this is everybody's favorite texture, which is called Fire Blue, and it tends to ruin stream quality at any time, basically. And this entire level is completely full of it.
Yeah, 3K, 4K, it just kills encoding just beyond what is possible.
So apologies to anyone who's having what appear to be technical issues. It's probably just the texture.
So there was a Cacodemon on the outside there who got me. I didn't even know he could shoot from there.
MLG right there.
Good shot.
Yeah,
have a $50 donation. Couch, put on your thinking caps. They say, glad to see these games being destroyed in a proper fashion. Another $50 of Couch can ID the origin of my name. The donor is Flynn Taggart.
That's the name of Doom Guy. It's Corporal Flynn Taggart, I believe.
According to the Doom Bible, right?
According to everything I've ever read about Doom.
Well, that's close enough.
So Gate to Limbo is just a massive maze, but by using the power of strafe running, we're going to be able to skip most of this map. It's going to be... I think there's two jumps we do, which are unintended. Right after we pick up the red key here.
Yeah, fun fact, when the original game came out, none of the developers supposedly knew about strafe running whatsoever. So when Doom 2 came along, they at least knew to some extent about strafe running, but they didn't know the possibilities of SR50, so then we still had the ability to break much of the game.
So that was one right there. Second one is coming up here. So we're going to go straight to the yellow key door, and then we do one last strafe jump to the exit.
This is the big one.
Yeah, this is the tough one, because he has to stop really quickly after getting across the gap.
Oops.
That Fortunately, there's a staircase, right. So he can just Too retry far right. it.
Too far right.
Now. There Good. We go.
And now for one of the best boss battles, like, ever.
I'm going to go for the armor just because I'm too low.
Mm, here's the spider, and there's the spider.
Yep. Yeah, we're done. Dang.
Oh, you didn't show the ending.
I don't think it shows the ending in Competition Doom.
Oh,
okay.
It just like goes straight to Episode 4.
Speaking of Episode 4, this is the one that was added for the Ultimate Doom, and it's a treat. It's kind of hard, especially this first level. I think a lot of people might just try to play this game on this episode and just stop at this level, because this is really hard.
Yeah, there is one green armor, right? Or
one
is there
green
no armor?
Armor?
I couldn't remember if there was an armor.
It's one green armor and 6% health, and that's it. That's all you get.
And like three barons, so it's good stuff.
I think that is one other thing we didn't go over, is how armor works in this game. So anytime you are under 100 or less percent armor reduces damage you take by 1/3. So if you were to take a hit of 30 damage, you take 10 off your armor and 20 off your health. Anywhere between 101 and 200% reduces by half.
Oh, and that's a BFG in the wall. I just got it.
It's best BFG.
So that BFG grab was actually one of the keys to completing this IL, I believe. People were having a lot of trouble completing that IL from pistol start before someone found out you could actually grab the BFG through the wall.
Yeah, we didn't see it, but you might have been hearing a cyber demon clomping. There is a cyber demon in the second level of this episode, so this is pretty good.
Let's go back around here.
You gonna go for it or? Nah, okay.
Nah, it's really, really inconsistent.
There's a way to skip this entire level, but it's an incredibly challenging jump. Which
it requires rocket jumping off one of the lost souls that's kind of just floating in the air, which obviously is, though it may not be moving too fast, is a moving target, and that kind of makes the setup a little bit random.
Right. Alternatively, I believe it's the absolute maximum possible jump you could do, so it requires the most ridiculous setup, and mm-hmm. it's either way, it's you might as well just go through the level. Especially in the marathon setting.
Now we get into two awful maps, which I think American McGee just gave up here.
E4, M4. It's just like the most unmemorable level.
So you can do donations?
Sarstar donates $25 and said, I'm so sad that I missed Dime's final Doom run, but so stoked that the ultimate Doom challenge was made. Good luck on E4 M6, and remember, old soldiers never die. They just turn into bloodthirsty mutant zombies.
We're all soldiers now.
And I have $200 from Chill and Bitters, who say, we remember when Dime was a young noob crushing in StarCraft. Good luck on the run, and you have Calgary's support.
NRG Dime.
NRG Dime.
And Lam Deerg sent in $50 and says, I just moved to California, so I don't have a ton of money to donate, but I'll always find something to give you guys. Save the world, but kill the animals.
You might notice that the monster variety by now, it's been rather, well, bland, I would say, just compared to Doom 2. You can make good maps for sure out of the Doom 1 stuff, and there have been mappers that make Doom 1 episodes, but for the most part, people consider Doom 2's menagerie the definitive way to map for this game.
Yeah, there's just a bit more variety that you can use.
Come on.
Especially one thing but that's a really big difference between Doom 2 and Doom 1 is the existence of Hell Knights, which basically are exact copies of Barons with about 60% health, so they're a lot better to use for just kind of generic enemy placement.
It might even just, I think it's just half health even, but either way, Barons are annoying, Hell Knights are less annoying.
So first skip here, we're just going to go straight to the teleporter, we're strafe running, and we go to the red key area right off the bat. I've got low health.
Holy crap.
I don't like this. I'm gonna do a.
That cacodemon.
Just kill.
He's cuddling the cacodemons, guys. It's fine.
There's no way I'd get through that level with like 20 health.
There's a fun surprise at the end. Fun. Yes. Never mind that this level has all this lava, and there are very few rad suits, as I recall. Maybe three-ish, but this level is kind of maze-like, or at least just difficult to do what you need to do, and you can run out of that and then just start running out of health, and it's pretty bad. These levels are a massive step up from the first three episodes, basically. This is almost like the Plutonia of Doom 1.
All right.
Yeah, you'll notice the Cyber Demon now.
So I have to stand forward here because he can splash off the staircase. And he doesn't really...
Nice, okay.
Oh, he doesn't care about me.
Yeah, sometimes that Cyber Demon can be a huge pain. It's in a really enclosed area, so it's not advised to try to fight him in close range.
So I'm going to try to show off a new trick here, which I didn't do last time. So if I can't get it, I'll save and load. There we go. So essentially, when we get to the key door here, I'm going to find a visual cue just by looking at a certain line depth. So as you can see here, I'm looking at kind of a... I don't know what color that is.
Brown?
Nice.
Brown. Anyway, you got first try. It's good.
So the exit switch for that level is just kind of in the ground, and there's a point where a trigger happens. I don't remember if it's a switch or a line depth or something, but it just raises out of the ground. So if you get on the platform, you can just press the switch before doing any of that stuff.
And last level in the game, right here.
Time will be when the transition for this level hits, after he kills the mastermind, more or less.
Yeah. This was the only... this was, like, episode one doesn't end immediately upon killing the boss, but there's actually a teleporter that you have to go into at the end of it.
Oh, you didn't do the rocket jump.
Oh, yeah.
It's the most
important
one. I
haven't done that in, like, a long time. It's just not even worth it.
Once again, say hello to Mastermind.
And say goodbye to the Mastermind.
All right.
This map is really easy just because you have way too much plasma.
Okay.
And we're done. Time.
So 28-18.
That's okay.
Not bad. The one
bad at all.
But E1M5. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyhow, I want to thank everybody for watching the Doom runs. It was really fun. And coming up next is going to be Hexen with Cubeface, I believe. Hexen and Strife.
One more time for Dime, everybody. And thanks so much for voting with your wallets to get us more Doom. I have $50 from Flynn Taggart again, who says, as promised. I believe Flynn was the name in the Doom novels. That might have been the first time Doom Guy was ever named. I do like Doom Guy, though, right? We could just call him Doom Guy, too, right? That's okay. Here's $25 from Anonymous who says, I'm loving Doom, but notice no one had bid to name anyone in Super Mario RPG, so let's call Mario Red Luigi. Keep up the great work, guys. Yeah, so when you go to donate at gamesdonequick.com to support Doctors Without Borders, you can send your donation toward one of many incentives, including naming people in Super Mario RPG. Yeah, if you want to join the Red Luigi bandwagon, you can go put your money toward that. I do have some other bids going on right now, though, that I want to let you know about. So up next, our game is Strife, and then after that, we'll be doing Hexen. And for Hexen, there's a class war bid happening. Your choices are cleric, a mage, sorry I said wizard earlier, and warrior, and sorcerer. No, just kidding, mage. So if you want to make the runner play the entire game as the mage, you can put your donation toward that incentive, or you could choose cleric, or you can choose warrior. I'm told Cubeface likes the cleric if you missed that. So check that out. Also, all of your donations automatically get you entered into a drawing for our prizes. Right now, you're eligible for the grand.